I want to chat a bit around a few things that I've observed that has worked in my market, in Nigeria and in Africa, and some of the things that that hasn't worked, you know, in the hope that many of you here today will have a role in the future, in the near future, that will require you to come and market into in Africa and specifically in Nigeria. Today, Nigeria is one of the is the fastest growing economy within the mint. You're familiar with the mint. That's Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. Nigeria is recognized as the fastest growing. It's the largest economy currently in Africa, larger than South Africa, $501 billion in GDP. And we have a middle class of about, out of a population of about 170 million people, we've got a middle class of about 24 million people. Now, 24 million people is 75% of the population of South Africa, and that is the population of all of Australia. And we have an incredible birth rate that, if I say the average birth rate is around, they like to put it as 3.5, and my question is always, where is the 0.5 baby coming from? But so I just say, averagely about 4. But, you know, the way to really look at the numbers is to say that by the end of 2015, the population growth just from babies born will be the equivalent of taking the country of Romania and putting it inside Nigeria. That's the way to look at it. Of course, this is somehow related to the fact that Durex in their survey said that Nigerians are the most sexually satisfied people in the world, you know. No further comments on that particular point. However, the question that we're trying to look at today is, at the end of the day, if you had a product and you were asked to bring that product into Nigeria or into Africa, how do you make money from your products? What do you need to do to sell successfully? And we have seen many clients that have tried to come into the market without succeeding, and then they pull out. And they give all kinds of reasons and comments on that. But over the years, I've discovered that this real secret is being able to arrive at the confluence of commerce, culture, and the consumer. Okay. If you could visualize that as a chart, you'd have a Venn diagram with three circles interlocking. Every brand that has succeeded on that continent have been able to arrive at that sweet spot, being able to bring together commerce, culture, and the consumer. And the businesses and the brands that have failed because sometimes they are able to do one well without doing the other two, or sometimes they are able to do two well and they can't do the third one, but they never get all three. And the key is always to get all three at the same time. And I'll talk about them one after the other, okay? In terms of commerce, what I mean by commerce here, I'm not talking so much about commercial skills. I'm talking really about understanding the market structures that you're going into. Is the market structure one that is a monopoly? Is it an oligopoly? Or is it a market that is perfectly competitive? And I'll use the beer market to describe this, for instance. Today, the beer market in Nigeria is not a perfectly competitive market. It's a market that is at best an oligopoly, which means we have a few players that have very strong market power, and then they control the market. So if I go into a pub in London, I'll see so many variety of beers, wouldn't I? I'll see more than 20 to 25 brands, and then you've got the draft beers over there. I can open a tap and all of that. If you come to a bar in Nigeria, you will not see the taps, first of all. And then what you see is that you see just about a few brands of beer, and the players are dominated, the big players that run the market. It's Nigerian Breweries, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of Heineken. And then you've got Diageo through the Guinness business. And almost every beer, there's a third player anyway, but they are not as strong. Almost every beer brand that you drink in Nigeria comes from these two or three players. So that's a market that is not a perfectly competitive market. Okay? The spectrum of brands available to appeal to the palate of the consumers in there is not broad. Now, if you have that kind of market from a commercial point of view, and you wanted to take a beer brand into that market, you have to worry about that structure. Because one of the things you'll have to do in terms of assessing your market structure, you'll have to take the C-Star index. If you've done some macroeconomics, you'll understand this. Or you take your HHI index, you know, to give you an idea of where the market power, how the market power is distributed within that market. Now, if you come into that kind of market from a commercial point of view, you have to be concerned about that structure, because in a structure like that, collusion is possible. If you have 2 to 3 strong players controlling any market, they can decide, they can change pricing as they will. Okay? They can decide on products, they can raise entry barriers very significantly and make it difficult for anybody else to enter into that market. Now, the moment that comes in, the first thing you need to worry about is not the superiority of your brand proposition. You haven't gotten to that yet. You have to first be able to enter the market, first of all. And then the question will be, if you have that kind of market, how do you break into that market? You break into that market typically by influencing government policies. Because whenever you see a market like that anywhere in the world, it's typically because there is some government policies involved that is not allowing, that is allowing that structure to exist. Okay? So one of the things that is done in the US is that according to the US antitrust laws, if you have a market that by commercial structure, the HHI index is above 2000 or 2.0 by factor, you typically have that in an industry where there are about 3 to 4 very strong players controlling about 80% of the market share. What typically happens according to US antitrust laws is that they will begin to discourage mergers and acquisitions within that particular structure, because any of the two players can decide to merge with the other ones, isn't that so? And suddenly they become more powerful and they dominate the entire market. And so the laws of marketing won't come into play at that point. Okay? Now, if you're going to come into a market like that, you have to find your way first to the government and find a way to get the government to create policies that would diffuse the power within that market so that you can come in with your brand or with your product as a player. It has another flip side. The flip side to it as well is that you can actually use that if it's in a market that really is not, the country is not too developed in terms of their economic policies, you can actually come and control the market. So a good example is MTN South Africa is the number one telecommunications provider in Nigeria. And what they basically did was when they looked at the Nigerian market, nobody wanted to go there. Because it looked like the price of mobile phones was too high for Nigerians to afford, and so on and so forth. It's a mistake that a lot of people have regretted since then, because there was a fundamental cultural insight, and I'll talk about that in a minute, which is that Nigerians talk a lot. It's the reason I'm looking at my notes, so that I don't talk too much. I stick to the notes, you know. But MTN understood that, so they came in. And what they did was that they paid such a high licensing fee to the government that one of the things they got the government to do was to put in a policy that made it very difficult for any other player to come in. And within their first year, they made back all their investment within the first year. Okay. And there was one year within their second or third year, the total profit after tax made by MTN was more than the entire profit after tax made by all the banks in Nigeria put together. Simply because Nigerians talk a lot. They don't save a lot, but they talk a lot. You know. So anyway, so they did that. They influenced government policy and used that to create a market structure that's very difficult for anybody to come there. And so you have like about 3-4 strong players, and they are the guys running the market, you know, and that has a lot of implications for their marketing. What basically now happens is because also the average Nigerian uses about 2 mobile lines simultaneously, the battle is against each other. They are always fighting each other. They are always, you know, replicating each other's marketing campaign all the time. So understanding that structure, what is going on there, is very, very important. Now, the second thing that you also need to understand that's very key is culture. There are serious cultural nuances, and I've seen so many experienced marketers ignore this in my career, and it's very painful. It can be very painful, you know. I remember I was at Cannes, and the global marketing director for some big multinational brand in Nigeria, they aren't doing so well right now, got up on stage, and he said that, there's no point doing anything with mobile in Nigeria, because when it comes to mobile, Nigeria is a dark continent, and nobody goes there. And I walked up to him after. I said, you know, you are wrong, by the way. That at that time, we had about 60-65% mobile penetration. And I told him that then our population was 160 million. I said, 160 million people, 65% of them have a mobile line. We are not a dark continent, when you're a dark country when it comes to mobile. He said, yeah, it's not, you know. And then we had this argument and all that. So after a while, I looked at him and said, this guy doesn't know anything. I didn't tell him that bit, by the way. And then a year and a half later, their business began to fail. And one of the reasons why their competition was beating them was that the competition was engaging the consumers on mobile. Because again, Nigerians talk a lot. It's a very important insight, you know. Being aware of these cultural nuances and how it influences buying behavior is very important. I'll tell you a story about that I heard about China. So Audi tried to launch their cars in China, the sedan cars. And it was a total failure, a dismal failure. And they had to pull out. And then they did some research to understand why they failed. Very simple. If you're familiar with the Jet Ofsted cultural dimensions, if you're not, I recommend you check them out. It's in a brilliant book called Cultures and Organizations, The Software of the Mind. It talks about the 10 cultural dimensions, things like power, distance, uncertainty, avoidance, and so on and so forth. One of the things that is typically characteristic of emerging markets is that there is huge power distance, huge. It's very important. You would never see in an emerging market where the students will call the professor by name. It's not going to happen. You know, I mean, everybody here calls Peter, isn't it? Good. If you're in a Nigerian university and you called your professor by name, you just failed the course. You know, power distance has to be there. In the offices, you don't address people by name. You address them by title. You know, hierarchies are important. So in China, the owners of the luxury cars, the guys who were rich enough to buy it, felt insulted because the distance between them and their drivers was too short. And that's why they didn't buy the Audis. So the Audi guys figured it out, and then they changed their model for China such that the Audi sedan cars in China are longer. So when the man sits at the back, there is more power distance between him and his driver. Immediately they did that, their sales went through the roof. Very basic insight. Now, it's important to understand those insights and to look at them from an agnostic point of view, not from a point of view of whether one culture is better than the other. In my personal view, there is no culture that is better. Because if you look at from an anthropological point of view, culture is simply the way a group of people decide to solve problems. By that definition, no culture can be better than any other. Culture is what we decide will work for us. That's just it. So if that is the case, if you go into a developing market, the question you have to ask yourself is, how have these people decided to relate with each other? Because that influences their buying behavior. It's very, very important. In a culture where there's a lot of hierarchy, your position within the society is a very key component of your personal identity. And that being so, it then means that your consumption behavior, your consumption habits, will to a large extent be influenced by the role that society has allocated to you. Okay, does this make sense? You wouldn't buy a shirt because that's what you feel like buying. No, You buy it because by your status in the society and by the role you play within your small community, that is what you're expected to buy. That's how it works. And it's important to be sensitive to those things. It's important to know those things, to be aware of them. Now, to the issue of the consumer, it's very important to look at the consumer through the right lenses. One of the worst lenses you can look, well, not the worst, but definitely not the best, you can look at the consumer through is through the lens of quantitative data. It doesn't tell you anything. And I worked as a researcher for many years, so I can tell you this. It doesn't tell you anything. It just gives you, at best a snapshot. You've got to look at a whole lot of other things. Now, the quantitative data is part of it, is useful, but you don't get everything. You've got to look at other things, for instance, like theories of personality from a psychological point of view. And I'll talk about a couple of theories and relate them to how to market specifically. One of the theories, there are about 17 theories of personality development in psychology. One of them is the African theory of personality development. It's a very interesting theory. I'll tell you what the theory says. The theory says that when God made man, the body parts were separate and they didn't come together as it is now. And that at some point, there was a revelry in heaven and the body parts got drunk and decided to dance. But they could not dance individually. So they decided to arrange themselves in a manner that will allow them to dance. And so they arranged themselves the way we are today. And while they were dancing, Satan, who in African theology is not a bad guy, he's just a mischievous guy, more like Loki, if you will, was passing by and he looked at what the body parts were doing and he thought, this looks nice. And so he cast a spell that fixed the human body that way. And that was how we were made. Okay. It sounds very funny. But the point of that is that the part you play is a function of the position that you are born into. So, if you are the firstborn in a family, that role defines the rest of your life. If you are the middle child, it defines the rest of your life. If you are the last child, it defines the rest of your life. Because that is the position that the gods have put you into. And therefore, that position determines how you relate with other people. It's a bit similar to the generalized interpersonal theory of personality development that has eight dimensions. And one of the dimensions is your birth position. And I find that, I think the guys that first realized that birth position was important for marketing was the mobile phone guys that come into Nigeria. So in most other markets, when you have the high-end phones, if you were to position or segment your product portfolio, you would say that, and you are a handheld device manufacturer, you would say that the phones below $100 will be for people in the lower class, isn't it? Phone between maybe $150 to $200 will be to the middle class. And phones about $300 and above will be to the upper class. Isn't that so? When you come to Nigeria, it's totally different. The phones $300 and above, guess who uses them? The lower class. And sometimes young people who don't have the income to buy these phones. And then you find the rich guys who have the income to buy the phones. They use phones of about $200. What is going on here? You know, what is going on? This was why for many years, Apple refused to come into Nigeria. It didn't make sense to them. Because they looked at quantitative data, and what did quantitative data say? It says that 70% of the population is in the lower class. And if you look at that from an American lens, lower class means they can't, 70% of the population cannot afford to buy an iPhone. That's what it says. So they didn't come in. Samsung took a different look and said 70% are lower class. What are they doing? Where is their money coming from? And they figured out that in the African society, if you are born as the firstborn, it is expected that you will continually maintain the lifestyle of the people below you. One. Two, because we have a proverb that says if you want to travel fast, you travel alone. If you want to travel far, you travel together. You are expected that if you are the wealthiest person within the family, you must, you know, be benevolent to the rest of the family in order that there won't be too much gap between your lifestyle and theirs. So what happens is that the man at the top in the family is earning a decent income. He has about three brothers. Let's pick one of them, the last born. The last born is in the university. He's standing there. He's got an elder brother who is maybe, I don't know, a rich guy somewhere. He's got an uncle somewhere who is also a rich guy. And he's got an auntie who is a rich guy. This guy, by African culture, has three sources of income. Four, in fact. Number one is parents. Number two is brother. Number three is uncle. Number four is auntie. So what happens? This guy goes home and tells his parents that he needs a mobile phone. Parents say, okay, I can only afford $100. He said, fine, I'll manage it. He takes it. Goes to meet the brother, I need a phone. Brother says, I can give you 150. Guess, how much does he have now? 250, right? Goes to the other one and says, I need a phone. By the way, all four of them are not communicating, so they don't know what's going on. He says, I need a phone. They give him another $100. He's got 350 now. And then he goes to meet the auntie who dotes on him a lot. And auntie gives him 200. Guy takes this money, he goes and buys an iPhone. The guy here has many like him connected to his income, right? He has one source of inflow, multiple sources of outflow. Because of that, he is careful and he cannot buy a phone that is more than $200. Apple looked at the chart and read it the wrong way, because they missed the cultural nuances. Samsung got it right. So Samsung came into the market, and in a short while, we found young people who had no jobs buying Samsung Galaxy. And then the older ones who had the jobs were buying Samsung Grand Duos, which is a cheaper phone, by the way. You know, because the source of income was different. These guys looked at another factor, which was disposable income, okay? And then they entered. Eventually, I think they figured it out. Now we have an Apple store in Nigeria. This was after they suddenly discovered that for some strange reason, a lot of the pirated apps downloaded in Africa was being downloaded in Nigeria. And then somebody asked the question, but we don't sell iPhones there, and we don't sell iPads there. Where are they getting it from? Well, this is how the money is flowing. And by the way, these people have siblings who are middle class, aunties and uncles, who will travel to the UK for holiday. And guess what this guy is asking them to buy him? An iPhone and an iPad. And guess what the auntie is using? A notebook and a pen. You see? These are the nuances that it's important to understand about the consumer. And then be able to bring all three together. What does the markets look like commercially in terms of the market structure, how it is organized? What does the entry barrier, what does it look like? What is sustaining the entry barrier? What's holding it? And how can we get into that? Okay. And then culture. What does the culture look like? What are the nuances of the culture? So on Wednesday, I was discussing with the guys, and I was telling them about the cultural preference to how a woman has to look. Because in the culture, the woman is an extension of the man, an extension of the man's identity, and an expression of the man's social status. Because of that, it is important that the housewife looks very robust. We have different nice ways of describing it, but the opposite of slim. Okay. It is important because if you're married and your wife has given birth to three children and she's looking slim, you are a wicked man. You are not taking good care of your wife. Your wife is not eating well. But if your wife is looking robust, then you can go to the family meeting and say, have you seen my wife lately? So totally different culture. And it has nothing to do with, all the usual topics of women empowerment and all of that. It's just the way society is organized within in those places, it's just the way it is. In some parts of the country, it is believed that the more robust a woman is, the more fertile she is. Absolutely ridiculous from a scientific point of view. But you may, if you stay in the country long enough, you see single ladies that are about to get married suddenly begin to eat a lot so that they can look fertile and all of that. So it's just a culture. Okay? So what are some of the things that's very important here? It's very important to be willing to adapt while you retain your core. Okay? To look at the nuances and not just bring a global template and say, this is how we market and we'll stick to marketing this way. So Lucozade for many years struggled, the energy drink, not the core concentrate, Lucozade Boost. While they are the leader within the energy and health drink category in the country, they've been struggling to grow for a long time. And the reason is that this was prior to GSK selling it off to Suntory. The reason is simply because they were unwilling to adapt their marketing approach to what was going on in the market. So GSK has a global template for marketing, right? And part of the global template is how the channels you must use for marketing different products. And it's fine to come to a country like Nigeria and use those channels, but there were other channels that were opening up. We're in a country where there is so much traffic, you spend two to three hours going to work in the morning, 2 to 3 hours in the coming back in the afternoon. And then, in the evening, sorry. And then if you have to go for client meetings in the afternoon, business meetings, because FaceTime is a very important cultural indication of respect. If you had a meeting with a client, you couldn't say you wanted, let's teleconference the meeting. It would be seen as if you are disrespectful to the client and you are not serious about the business. So you have to, most every meeting has to be FaceTime. FaceTime means you have to drive to 2 hours of traffic to get there, another 2 hours to come back. So a one-hour meeting will cost you 5 hours man time. Now, guess what happens to people when they are in traffic and they are driving? They get tired, right? What do they need? They need some energy. Isn't that so? Lucozade refused to sell in traffic. Coca-Cola was selling in traffic. They started selling in traffic when a local manufacturer brought in a fizzy drink, apple-based drink called La Casera. And it was selling in traffic because you are there in the hot sun. We are sweating right now in Nigeria, and I was on the plane and the pilot said, the weather is warm in London right now, 5 degrees. I'm like, what? I'm coming from 30 degrees. It is not warm, it's cold. But anyway, it's warm in London, 5 degrees. So you are there in traffic, you're sweating, you are burnt out, you've got a meeting, you need a cold drink. Somebody comes, simple distribution system. Small children, some of them teenagers, they have this transparent bag. They've put ice blocks inside and they put the drinks there. So the drinks are cold. They carry it on their shoulders and they run after you. And you pay them and they give you change, right? You take the drink, you drink it, you're refreshed. For years, Coca-Cola didn't bother to look at that until suddenly this product, La Casera, gained 5% market share without any advertising at all. And then Coke said, you know what, it's time we go into the traffic as well, because everybody is drinking there. So the same thing, 1 year, Lucozade suddenly saw a new energy drink product called Bullet come into the market. And in 1 year, Bullet gained 22% market share, 1 year, without any advertising. Of course, the client freaked out and were called into all these meetings. And guess what was happening? Bullet was selling in traffic. But the global marketing template for GSK does not allow them to sell in traffic. But the question is, do you want to make money or do you want to follow a program and tick boxes? That's the hard question to answer, isn't it? Do I want to come into this market and go back to my global marketing director and say, I tick the boxes, but where's the profit? Nothing. And get fired or redeployed to, Lumumbashi or something. You know, or do I want to come in here, succeed, and make money? If I'm going to make money, I have to check what is going on ground. You know, the other thing that, relating the Lukoje story again, was that we, in doing market visits, we observed that a lot of, now, Lukoje boost is meant to be for, you know, you're down, you want to increase your health and all of that, energy levels, isn't that so? We found out that in bars, it was being used for something different. The big question is, how did Lukoje boost get into the bars in the first place? But that's another story. In bars, we found out that, you know, consumers were doing cocktails with Lukoje boost and Smirnoff Ice. By the way, you should try it. It tastes exactly like champagne. Trust me on this. It tastes exactly like champagne. Cheaper version of champagne, but fine. You know. So they were mixing this. Why were they mixing it? Very simple. Energy drinks increase your metabolic rate, right? So if you're consuming alcohol and you're consuming energy drinks at the same time, your increased metabolic rate will slow down your ability to get drunk. So you can drink for longer and hop around bars throughout the night. The consumers found this out by themselves. Nobody taught them. Okay? And we went to Lukoje. Would you be kind enough to let us do in-bar activations? They said, no, it's a health product. Globally, we have this standard, we have that standard, we can't be seen in bars. But you're already in bars. The consumers are taking you into the bar. So why not go into the bar, activate there, and sell? No, we're not going. They are taking you into the bar. We're not going. They are taking you into the bar. And then all of a sudden, our good friend Bullet, guess what they did? They came up with a pre-mixed cocktail of energy drink and vodka. And again, they took the market. And this was done without any above-the-line campaign, by the way. You know, the product was flying off the shelf like crazy. Because they simply came, observed the markets, observed what the consumers were doing, what their behavior and what their habits were, and all of that, and just used it. And they are making money. Okay? So, as I said, you know, balancing the three is really very important. And the best way that I found that it has worked, you know, is to always partner with a local agency. And this may sound cliche, but this is the truth. The reason is that the local agencies definitely understand the market. They have the right insights to the market. They've been in the market for so long. Not only are they walking out of the market, they are part of the market. They can tell you the nuances. They can tell you how to take your product into the market. They can tell you how to do your packaging and bring it into the market, you know, and how to go about it. All of those things, those are the things that would really, really help you to succeed. Most importantly, they can help you to design the right kind of marketing program that would actually connect with these consumers and work with them. You know, you've got to do that. You've got to do that. It's very, very important. Bringing all of this together is very key. And then I was sharing some things about how to look at the African consumer on Wednesday. And one of the things I talked about, and I think is worth repeating, is the value of an enemy. It's one of the psychological constructs that make up the consumer. And how, for the African consumer, it is important for them to have an enemy. Achievement is defined by your ability to overcome the barriers that have been placed in front of you by your enemy. You don't want to become a musical star because you have a gift for singing. You want to become a musical star because your uncle said you can never sing. So the point is you are doing it to prove him wrong. It's very simple. And it's something that actually can be useful in marketing. Because if you understand the enemies of your target audience or your target consumer, then all you need to do is to position your product as the enemy of their enemy, which means the product is their friend. It's just it's just that simple. Remember that the best way to look at culture is to take an agnostic view. It's what people decide that this is how they want to live their life. It works for them. Doesn't matter whether it's better than my culture or not. That's not relevant. What's relevant is, how do I make money in this market? How do I go into this space and get them to buy my product? Okay, what do I need to do? What languages do I need to speak? So we find that for every campaign that we do in the agency, we actually have to adapt it language-wise, because with a country 250 different ethnicities, 250 different languages. We have a lingua franca for English. The only reason we picked English as our lingua franca is because we're arguing over which of our languages should be the lingua franca. So, okay, you know what? Let's take English. It's not anybody's language. End of discussion. But after English, right below it, next layer, there are 3 to 4 other major languages that are spoken: Hausa, Yoruba, Igbo, and Pidgin. Okay? Every campaign that we do, we discover that we have to translate it. And proper translation, because the same words are not the same across. Isn't that so? You know, and sometimes not just translation in terms of language, translation in terms of cultural nuances. So we work for Cadbury Bonvita for a number of years. We still do. And whatever we did, no matter the campaign, they just could not sell their products in the southeast of the country. You know, it's just that difficult. I mean, 250 ethnic groups, it is easier for a Nigerian to marry a British person than it is for a Nigerian from the southwest part of Nigeria to marry somebody from the southeast in the same country. I'm telling you. I mean, just those two parts, apart from difference in language, there's difference in culture, there's difference in the role of man and woman in the marriage, there's difference in palate, in consumption palate completely. And so we never could crack, you know, why the guys in the southeast were not drinking Bonvita. Okay? And then we send some guys there, some planners to go in there and do a focus group and just observe. And guess what we found out? In the southeast, as at then, they believed that when pregnant women consume Bonvita, they get malaria. Shocking, right? Absolutely shocking. Where did that come from? In that part of the country, more than perhaps any other place in the country, you know, role hierarchy is very strong. So if you're a woman, a young woman, first-time mother, whatever your mother or your older aunties tell you, you accept it hook, line, and sinker, no editing. So some of the older women are told, passed it down to the younger women, that during pregnancy, if you drink Bonvita, you have malaria. Because, by the way, that woman who has malaria during pregnancy, remember that she drank Bonvita yesterday. It's ridiculous, I'm telling you. But and they believed it. And guess what's happening? First time mom, 9 months she's pregnant, she doesn't touch Bonvita. After 9 months, she's formed the habit, right? It's difficult for her to go back. And then 1 year later, she has a second child, another 9 months, she doesn't touch Bonvita. By the third child, Bonvita is out of the home, completely. So we then had to, before we're doing brilliant ATL campaigns and, you know, talking about the brand and, you know, the benefits of the brand and so on, all the nutrients. The battle was not a battle of nutrients. It was a battle of perception. And so we then had to take a particular lady that was considered very respectable in that part of the country, because she was a famous actress. She's elderly, she's a great homemaker, etc., etc. And then we had to take her on road shows from town to town, you know, and she was then telling the women that it's not true, nothing happens to you if you drink, and then she would make Bonvita and drink a cup right in front of them and so on and so forth. And that was when, you know, some improvement I was seeing over there. Now imagine you, we're in the market and we had this issue. Now imagine if you had to come from outside the market and you were coming with some global template that, you know, you refuse to adapt. I mean, the brand is dead on arrival. It's just a countdown, literally. So this is what I've discovered that works every time. 100% of the time, if you follow this, you know, it works. And my final recommendation to you, you should expect this. If you ever want to come into Africa, just send me an email. We do this best, trust me. Thank you.